Hello, everyone. And it has been an incredible morning so far. My name is Ruby Mitchell, and I serve as a women's ministry leader here in the Greater Philadelphia Church of Christ. I am so honored to be able to introduce our guest speaker, Megan Zillman. She's a women's ministry leader from the Denver Church of Christ. Megan has been married, and she married her high school sweetheart for 23 years. She is the mother of 5 children, 4 sons and 1 daughter, and the ages are from 19 to 5 years old. So give her props, ladies. Chip's word for Megan is that she's a woman of tenacity. That was his word for her. As a Hoosier, that just means she was born in Indiana. She was raised there. And she played basketball both in high school and on a collegiate level. In fact, Megan, who graduated from Smith College, along with Brandon Beskones, which we all know and love, that was here in Philadelphia, were converted about the same time during that time. Megan has been in the ministry for 22 years. She and her husband have led several different places in the campus ministry in Boston. That's where I had the honor of knowing her. She served in Chicago, the Chicago church, for about 14 years, and she is presently, she and her husband, leading the church in Denver. Megan is a woman of devout faith and love for the word of God. She's a sister's sister, a woman of deep convictions and deep love for others. Megan has great wit and her own brand of sisterhood, and I've had the pleasure to see her as a single woman, a woman new in her faith, and also in her marriage to Chris. Do you know she made her own wedding dress? Yeah, that's the kind of woman she is. Till now. And so she's a woman I deeply love and admire for her honesty, her joyful spirit, and her undeniable love for her Lord and his people. And Megan, I can't tell you enough how much I am so grateful to have been a part of your journey and that you're here today to speak to us about filling our cups. I give to you Megan Zillman.
Good morning. Thank you guys so much. It's, as always, such a weird thing to have people talk about you while you're sitting there and a bunch of people are looking at you. So just so we're clear, I just put it on gallery because I can't sit here and watch myself. But so I'm in my husband's space. I tried to make it girly on this side, but I have, like Ruby said, I have 5 kids. And so this is like the only space I can come to where I can lock the door. So I can't guarantee that there's not going to be some knocks. Some, you know, my kids will walk past their dad to come down to ask me if they can have a granola bar. So you guys might get a deal with some of my family a little bit today. But like Ruby said, we live in Denver. Is there any way to get the picture up of my family? I'll show you my crew. So my oldest son there, he started college. He goes to the University of New Mexico. He started college this year. And then my youngest, the daughter, she actually started kindergarten this year. So my husband and I always tell people we have 3 last babies. So the 3 smallest here are our 3 last kids. And so we finally actually made it official, and we're going on. But I also like to use these pictures when I share a picture of my family, because I'm trying to entice you all just to move out here. Like this is Colorado. And guys, I'm a Midwesterner, I'm a Flatlander. And yet this does something for the heart. So if anybody's interested, feel free to join us, but you could take that down now. I'm so excited to be with you guys. My sister's from Philadelphia, from the East Coast here. I want you to know, like, the reputation that you have in Philly and in Pittsburgh. You guys have a reputation for being tough. You guys are tough people. You're gritty people, right? And I also heard that Hershey is here. And I was told that Hershey is known as the sweetest place in the world or something. So I don't want to mess with the Philly and the Pittsburgh people, but I honestly feel like I probably could mess with you Hershey people a little bit. So, yeah, we'll see. No, but I'm actually reading a book right now, and the author's from Philadelphia, and he was talking about He and his wife have a special needs daughter. And he said his wife, after years of just crying out to God on their daughter's behalf, she felt like God wasn't doing anything, that God didn't care, that God wasn't listening. So she stopped praying her daughter's name and started praying her daughter's social security number. And he called that a Philly lament. And I was like, okay, I can respect that. I can respect a people that lament in that way, that are not afraid of being honest, that are not afraid of being a little bit gritty with their Lord. I am a white woman born in the middle of America, okay, born in the late 70s. So you're probably going to assume that my cultural reference point to Philadelphia is Rocky, but you would be wrong. I'll tell you what my cultural reference point is. It's long overdue, and now Philly slamming. Are you with me? Are you with me? Here's my only question. So never skipped a beat. Nah, while cooling on Charles Street.
South Street.
South Street. This is what I needed all these years. I needed to come with you guys so I could, I've always sang Charles Street. I thought they were cooling on Charles Street. So, okay, we're cooling on South Street with our, all the Philly cheese steaks we can eat. So anyway, that's where we are here. I actually got to spend a little bit of time with your staff over Zoom a month or two back. And let me tell you, that is a group of women that loves each other. They laughed together, and their laughter together, it brought me joy, and it ministered to my heart at a time that I'm like, what's going on? Everybody's stinky. We're all hurting each other. It was just so, your staff loves you all so much. They love each other so much, and they ministered to me in that. And obviously, like Ruby said, I would be remiss if I didn't take this opportunity to just publicly thank Ruby Mitchell for the role she's played in my life. She actually sat down and studied the Bible with me. Okay. So she taught me how to become a Christian. She taught me how to become a minister. We went in the ministry with Chip and Ruby. She taught me how to be a wife because we were just married. And she taught me how to be a mother. My oldest son was born when we were Chip and Ruby. And so I think the thumbprint, if I was a crime scene, Ruby's thumbprint would be all over it. So Ruby, thank you. Thank you and Chip for what you've taught us and how you've led us. I know so many of you have had the chance to be with Ruby in that way. But so, okay, today we're talking about come fill my cup. And I think obviously there's a need for that after a year like this year, right? Just well played to whoever planned this, the committee that planned what the theme was going to do. We see you. We see what you did there. I think we all probably feel like we need a little bit of a top off, maybe a little bit more than a top off after a year like this. There's something that happens to us when we're running on empty. Is there not something that happens to us, both literally and figuratively, I think. Now, it's rare that this happens to me, but if there's a morning that I can't fill up my cup with coffee, look out. You know, I'm the laid back Midwestern Megan. I'll go Philly on everybody if I don't have my coffee, okay? So we need to be filled up. There's also something that happens when you moved. Again, I'm a Flatlander. You guys, Pennsylvania, you get a little bit, I would have called what you have there like super mountains until I moved to the Rockies. But you know, you go to these higher elevations and what do people do? They start pushing water on you. You need to drink, you need to drink, you need to drink, keep drinking over and over and over again. Because literally there's something happens that happens to us. You get headaches, you get stomach aches, you get altitude sickness if you're not filling up, if you're not continuing to drink. And I think that is crucial for us to even think about spiritually, emotionally, physically. That's not very dissimilar to what happens when we're running on empty, right? We get messed up and we get off, we get sick. I think when I'm running on empty, I get anxious. That's my go-to. And when I'm anxious, I get irritable. I'm not a gentle anxious person. I'm an irritable anxious person. I get touchy. You know, God forbid you leave a dish on the sink if I am feeling anxious. Okay. I go from passive aggressive to aggressive aggressive, just back and forth, whatever happens. Yeah, I wish we could, everybody could unmute. We could have a little confessional about what happens to you when your cup is on empty. But in all seriousness, I think that the longer we run on empty, the more used to it we get, right? And we begin to feel like this is just normal. This is life, you know, to run at quarter capacity. This is just how it is. And we lose the capacity to realize this is actually not normal. This is not how we were created to live. This is not how we were created to run. You know, it's not just my lot in life that I have to accept. And then I think the rare times that we do consider it, we're often so worn down that we don't consider it in a healthy way. And in my experience, what we do, that's when we begin to look around at one another and we begin to kind of put ourselves and others into categories, into different categories. And these categories may or may not be true, but they cause us to separate ourselves from one another. They cause us to put distance between one another. They make us pull back and build up our walls. Categories like, well, you know, if I had the supportive husband that she had, I wouldn't be so run down, right? Or if I had the amount of money that he has, yeah, it would be different. I wouldn't have to worry if my kids were older, or if I had the opportunities that that family had, or if I was healthy, like, so, you know, on and on. We each have the places that we go to when we're feeling ground down, and then we start categorizing. But here's the problem with that line of thinking. Not only does it categorize and separate, but it's built on the assumption that our circumstances, you know, the presence of this factor or the absence of that factor are what fills us up, are what gives us the ability to find peace and contentment and meaning in our lives. Now, hear me say, I'm not so naive to think that our circumstances have no bearing on our lives. I so appreciated, I believe it's Chandrika, so appreciated the rawness and the realness of you sharing your heart and the wrestle with God. Clearly our circumstances, they do have a bearing on our lives, right? The fact is we live in a broken and a fallen world. And so we each have to deal with that reality and the different realities that we each do have to deal with. Some realities, they're harder than others, and it's not fair, right? We do live in a world that's filled with inequality. We live in a world that's filled with injustice. Unfairness is all around us, right? So please don't hear me dismiss these realities. Please don't hear me say these aren't realities, but please do hear me say this. Our cups can be filled in spite of that. Our cups can be filled in spite of our circumstances if we know where to go. And here's the great news, okay? Staying filled up, it's not dependent on your circumstances, and it's not dependent on you. It's not dependent on me. We have someone who claims that responsibility, someone who wants to do it, okay? And we're gonna look in Psalm 23, because that's a song that was written, a psalm that it gives us insights into this. And I think it helps us set our cup goals, okay? Verse 5 talks about our cup runneth over. And if you grew up going to church, right, you know Psalm 23. You know it. But you probably, if you grew up going to church, you probably hear it, and there's a lot of F's. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. There's a lot of F's going on in there, okay? But Psalm 23 is typically thought of as kind of a funeral psalm. We tend to think of it as being a song that circles around death and everything, the concepts surrounding death. But that actually couldn't be farther from the truth. That's not what this psalm is about. It's not what this song is trying to convey. Psalm 23 is a psalm about life. And it's a song about life to the full. It's life as it was meant to be lived, right? As we were created to live it. It's a life lived with the opportunity to have a perpetually full cup. So if you would visit with me, just for a few moments, again, something I'm guessing most of you have heard countless times. We're going to just kind of meander through this psalm a little bit, and I'm not going to offer any new insights or hit you with any mind-blowing revelations, but I do want to emphasize and remind us and reset our hearts that we can get in a position, again, to position our cups to be filled. And if this is your first time hearing these words, again, I'm guessing not many of us, but if it is your first time, know that these are the words of an ancient song that was written 3,000 years ago in a world far away, in a time far away. But I ask you to hear, what if this is true? What if these words aren't just like the poetic musings of someone that lived 3,000 years ago that sound nice, but what if these words really are a key to how you can live your life today? You know, and if this is the 1,000th time you've heard these words, I invite you to hear them as if it's the first. Or certainly I invite you to hear them after living this past year, hear them anew, right? So as I said before, it's a song. It's a poem that was written 3,000 years ago by a man living in a culture completely foreign to ours, whose circumstances and technology completely different. And yet it's amazing because the things we'll see him address are the same things that our hearts long for today, right? Everything else has changed except us. We are who we are. Our hearts are who we are. So this song, it was written by a man named David, and he was actually the eighth son of a Hebrew shepherd named Jesse. And this man, David, would go on to become king. But this here, this song that we're reading, it's we don't see a king here. We just see a man who's trying to consider his life and its meaning and his God. And he's using the closest examples that he has to growing up, right? A shepherd and a sheep. Just like Will Smith took his experiences on the playgrounds in West Philadelphia, and he used that for his craft, okay? That's what David is doing in Psalm 23. So Psalm 23, it opens with this deep, profound thought that we're actually just gonna camp on for a second. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. Okay, so many times when I consider this opening line, I think I can emphasize the wrong half. My mind gravitates to that last bit, I lack nothing. And let me just say, stimulus check times five kids right now, I actually kind of do feel like I lack nothing, but that's not the point of what I'm trying to say here. But you know, the thought that lacking nothing, you know, that's pretty appealing. I think that's a Bible verse we can all get behind, right? But the point to this verse, it's not the second half, it's the first part of this verse. What comes after that comma, it's a direct outgrowth of what comes before it. It should almost say, because the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing, right? The heart of this verse, it's about my shepherd. It's not about what I have or don't have. The heart of this verse is about my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. Okay, so first things first, I'm assuming this is not like a heavily agrarian group of women on this call, right? So let's just cover basics. What does a shepherd do? Simply put, a shepherd's role is to take care of the sheep. They look out for the welfare of the sheep, not just as a herd, but as individuals within that herd, okay? They protect them from predators, they bandage wounds, they dispense kind of preventative medicine. They make sure they have access to fresh water and to food sources. The shepherd looks out for the sheep. Domesticated sheep are not able to meet their own needs. Can you throw that picture up real quick? I came across a news article of a sheep. This poor little girl, poor little guy, I don't know, we'll call her a girl, it's a woman's day. She was found in Australia recently, a few months back, in the wild, okay? This is a sheep without a shepherd. This sheep could no longer see. They're amazed at how this thing continued to live. They sheared 78 pounds of wool off of this sheep because it had just wandered away and was living in a wild. So first of all, after COVID, I know there were points in COVID that we all, we're with you, sister. We can relate to the way this little girl was looking. But this shows us that a shepherd cannot live with, or a sheep cannot live without a shepherd. This is what David knew. This is what David had in mind. You could take that down. Thank you. Now for us, okay, we're not quite as helpless as that sheep. But I would say, I think if probably most of us were lost in the woods for 2 years, we might not come out looking as good as that little sheep was looking, right? But we're basically able to care for ourselves, right? We can find food, we can find shelter, we're reasonably able to care for our offspring. But what we're aiming today, what we're talking about is a full cup, right? Not just survival, not just making it. And I don't believe that any of us were actually created to be able to keep our own cup filled and run on that level. You know, we're creatures created with needs that pull us to God and to other humans. We're built for relationship. We're built for connection. We need others. But here's the tricky part. The others that we need are also the ones that hurt us. Are they not? They're the ones that give us wounds. It's complicated. So you know what? We need a shepherd who can keep us, who can bandage our wounds, who can keep us in, keep the flock together. So for the sake of time, I'm asking you today, if you don't believe it, to just trust me for a minute that you need a shepherd. I need a shepherd, okay? But here's the thing, we don't just need any shepherd because you don't wanna put yourself at the mercy of just anyone. A flock's well-being is completely and utterly dependent on the care or lack of care that the shepherd gives. So you want a good shepherd, right? And lucky for us, there's one who claims to be just that, who volunteers, who laid down his life in order to be that. I'm referencing scriptures in John 10 here, but Jesus is having this discussion and he says this, and I'm reading this out of order. So if anybody has this memorized and you're like, what's she doing? I'm taking some liberties here, okay? But Jesus says, I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I've come that they can have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me, just as my Father knows me and I know my Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. So here's the thing. This shepherd, this good shepherd, he laid down his life for you. He did this. But I think this is an aspect that we know about. This is an aspect that we're used to hearing about. Here's another aspect in these verses that I ask you to consider today. I know my sheep and they know me. See, our good shepherd is a God of relationship and of connection. He's a God that he doesn't want you in his flock just for the bottom line. He's not looking at you for the stimulus check, what you're going to bring to him, right? He's not just looking for more sheep. He wants to know you and he wants to be known by you. And I don't have time to go through all the Bible passages that make these claims, but they're there. They are there. And I implore you to take the time to find them. If you've never, sit down with someone who can show you. If you do know them, go back and remind yourself. But here's a few of the claims that the Bible makes about this good shepherd wanting to know you and be known by you. He makes his thoughts known to you. He expresses his hurts and his joys to you. He limits himself by making himself knowable. Think about this. The promises that he makes so that you and I can understand him a little better, can trust him, can know what we can expect from him. He limits himself. He sets aside his rights, his powers, the things that he could do, he's God. He sets it aside so that you and I can come to him, can trust him. Can you imagine having that power and that's what you use it for? He also makes himself vulnerable. He risks rejection by you and by me because he wants us to choose him and be known by him. I mean, how crazy is that the creator of the universe comes to us like, you know, a forlorn, you know, I imagine this lovesick teenager asking a girl out on the date, how vulnerable that is. That's what the creator of the universe does for you and I, because he wants us to know him. And he knows you inside and out. He created you exactly as you are. And I believe he created you that way because he wants connection with you, right? He wanted relationship with you. Here's the thing. I look at a flock of sheep and you know what I see? I see a bunch of sheep. They all look fluffy. They look, you know, like sheep. But the shepherd looks at a flock of sheep and he sees not just the flock, he sees each individual sheep. He knows that, you know, that one over there had a hard time with her last lambing. And he knows that this one over there is prone to kind of wander off. And he knows this one needs another dose of medication tonight. He looks at the flock and he knows it. And in that same discussion in John 10, he says the good shepherd calls his own sheep by name, right? And leads them out. And his sheep follow him because they know his voice. It's very personal. It's very intimate. It's very safe. Consider this claim. God sees you and God knows you. And that's not a threat. That's not a threat. That's actually a promise of incredible comfort. This is your shepherd, guys. In another place, again, as it was talked about in the testimony, the shepherd describes the posture of his heart as being thus. I am gentle and humble in heart. Again, this is your promised shepherd. So do you know him? Do you want to know him? Do you hear his voice speaking you towards him? You know, Jesus also gives a sober discussion, a sober warning at this point, that he says there's a good shepherd, but then there's also the hired hand. The hired hand who wants to make the flock is kind of a means to an end. It's a job. I'll stand here and protect the flock, but I don't care. The minute danger comes, he runs. I don't have time today to go into the hired hands that I think seduce us into thinking that, oh yeah, this is safe. I'll go here for my shelter. But consider, you know, there's some wisdom. The world is peddling some wisdom to us, trying to make certain hired hands look like they're taking care of us, but they're not. Again, I don't have time to go into that today, but just consider what those might be. But the question is, again, do you believe that the good shepherd wants to know you and wants you to be known? You know, what does your mind say? And then ask yourself practically, what does your life say? What do the choices that you make every day say about that? So we're going to keep meandering here to the next verse. It says, he makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. On its surface, this passage is talking about just basic life needs being met, right? And thank you, God, for the comfort and security, for the fact that you have an eye on our needs. You know we need these things. They do matter to you, and you will provide them. But what's implicit in this verse is actually what's more important, what's more profound than this. You see, sheep are prey, okay? They're instinctively hardwired to flee in the face of danger. Whether the danger is real or perceived, they're going to run. There's no fight in them, right? The fight or flight, they just flee. They headlong flight. A sheep that lives in fear will literally die because it can't calm down long enough to eat. It can't calm long enough to drink. It can't calm down long enough to lay down. If a sheep is driven by fear, it will die. So a huge part of the role of the shepherd is not just to lead them to the water and lead them to the pastures. A shepherd provides security. A shepherd helps eliminate the fear. It provides safety from predators and from dangers that won't allow the sheep to rest, to stop. So, okay, the farm lesson's over. What does that mean for us? We have to talk for a second about fear and what it does for us. Because my entire professional career has been working with women, okay? And so over two decades, I've ministered across cultures. I've ministered across ages and races and income brackets and education levels, pretty much all seasons and stages of life. And one of the most common denominators across all these categories is the presence of fear. Okay, and hear me out, because I know some of you just dismissed me. Yeah, a lot of women are fearful. I'm not. But before you exempt yourself from this statement, consider this. I think fear, it's a present companion for most of us. And the list and number of things we have to be fearful for, it varies. But fear is often a motivator for so much of our movement, for so much of our restlessness, right? There's even a term for it, FOMO, fear of missing out. We just want to keep going. Our inability sometimes to lie down in the green pastures, to drink from the still waters, is driven by our fear. It steals our peace. It steals our love. And I think some of us mask it better than others. Some of us more readily admit it. You know, in the face of fear, some fight, some take flight, some are incapacitated, some are angry. But our good shepherd wants to protect us from that. He wants to help you sort through which of your fears are killing you, which of your fears are killing you, and get rid of them, and which of them are real. And then he wants to help us learn to trust him with the real ones. You know, back to this idea of knowing us and wanting to be known by us, he wants us to look so closely at him, to fix our eyes on him so totally, let him deal with the predators. You know, he's like saying, look, watch me. I know there's a wolf over there. I know there's a thief over there. You look at me and let me take care of these things. You look at me, fix your eyes on me. We live in an age of heightened fears, guys. And we have a media and a culture that's only going to stoke our fears and make us feel like we can't rest. We can't lay down. We can't stop. But if we can't be women that learn to entrust our fears to our good shepherd, we're going to live in a state of constant agitation. Our cups will never be full. Our cups will always be empty. We'll be ground down. Our needs will not be met. We need, in order to take care, hold of this life to the full, we need to fix our eyes on the shepherd with our fears. And here's the thing. I am a fearful person. It took me a shamefully long time to realize this about myself. Years and a life-giving conversation from my husband who helped me to see this. But I think when I'm afraid, I misplace my fear. The people that I love the most are the one that get it. Because when I'm afraid, I'm tense. I start to get controlling. I start to react. I start to act, you know, instead of just fixing my eyes on Jesus. And here's the thing. After 25 years of being a Christian, I've not learned how to not be fearful. I haven't. But I am growing in knowing what to do with my fears. I'm learning to identify them. I'm learning to own them. I'm learning to talk about them with vulnerability, not just with anger. That's where I can lead with it. And I'm learning that I can fix my eyes, that I can trust my shepherd and fix my eyes on him. And if your shepherd is good, I promise you, you can do the same. He keeps going and he says, he guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. So what's going on here? What's the imagery that David is evoking in these verses? The shepherd has to bring the sheep through the valleys, up into the higher pasturage in the spring, so that the flock can be up there in the spring and the summer, because that's where they get their needs met. That's where the food is. That's where, you know, he's already gone out and he's prepared the pasturage and he has to lead the sheep up there. But it's a hard journey. It's often perilous. It's dangerous. There's small, skinny trails. There's predators in the trees. There's deep drops and just kind of sudden crevices. The shepherd doesn't take his sheep along these paths, guys, just for fun. He doesn't take his sheep along because he's an adrenaline junkie or he's bored or just to toughen them up. He's taking his sheep where they need to go for their own good. He's taking them to this pasturage, to the higher elevations, to the banquet that he's prepared for them, right? To the feast where the cup runs over. And he sometimes has to use the rod and the staff to guide the sheep because they don't want to go along these dangerous places, right? They don't want to go along these scary paths. This brings us to ourselves and our hard times, doesn't it? And I don't know about you, but I feel very shepherded when I'm lying next to those still waters, when I'm lying in the green pastures, when my cup is running over. You are a good shepherd. I feel that then. But how do you feel when you're being led through the valley of the shadow of death? When life is feeling hard and precarious and dangerous, or when the shepherd is using his rod and staff to comfort you, to bring you back into things, do you still believe you're being shepherded in these moments, in these scary, horrible times? Are you convinced that the shepherd has fled and you're on your own now? You got to come up with it. A few years ago, I was just being a responsible woman, minding my own business, you know, and I went to get a mammogram. Right? Doing what we're supposed to do. Thank you very much. When it was over, I'll just wait for my letter where you tell me, come back in a year and all will be good. Right? But I didn't get a letter. I got a call. And if any of you know anything about this, you know, you don't want to be like that with the mammogram technician. You don't want to be talking on the phone with this woman. Right? So long story short, I was diagnosed with breast cancer. You know, I ended up needing a double mastectomy. And they sent me into menopause afterwards, and I'm in treatment for 10 years. It's been almost 3 years. So there's a sense of where it is what it is now, okay? But initially, I so clearly and distinctly, I remember the day after the diagnosis when it was all still so fresh, and I didn't know what this was gonna mean. I didn't know where this was gonna lead. My daughter, the next day, turned 3. And so I remember sitting in the living room and singing happy birthday to her and like trying to hold it together. Cause in my mind, everything was like, oh my God, is this the last, is this my last birthday? You know, is this the last thing I'm going to see? Jasper, my fourth boy, my second youngest child was about to start kindergarten in the fall. I'm like, I'm not going to see him start kindergarten. What about my boys, my 3 teens that are old enough to know what's going on? And what about my husband? We've been together since we were children. We were supposed to grow old together. Like these are all the things that were going through my mind. I had some fears about my shepherd's plan in that moment, right? What was he doing? And honestly, I can say, I never did doubt his goodness. I never did doubt his motivation. But I can say I hated his plan. I hated it. I was so resistant. I was so afraid of where he was taking me, right? I was afraid of the paths he was leading me on, and I did not want to go. I did not want to go on those paths. You know, I wanted to be with him, but I didn't want to go there with him, right? It wasn't where I wanted to go. Where are you leading me, God? There was so much wrestling, despair, anger, weakness, fear, sadness. I'm wrapping my brain around that. And 3 days later, I get an early morning call from one of my best friends. She was a young woman, her and her husband. We had been training him in the ministry. We were mentoring them. They were our kids, actually team leaders. And so they had spent that week wrestling with us and helping us process and praying with us and helping our teenagers process and go through. And she was about to welcome her second child. She was due that week with their second baby, a little boy. So Becca had gone into labor on Friday. So all night I'm kind of waiting. Saturday morning, I get a text from her and I grab my phone. I'm like, okay, how big was he? What time did he finally arrive? And, but the words I saw, they made no sense to me. I picked up my text and it just said, Meeks, we lost Judah. And I like literally remember trying to process, what do you mean? What are you talking about? You lost Judah. So their easy pregnancy, this great young Christian couple pouring out their lives for God, their healthy baby boy had died for no reason. They could never find out why. He never took a breath. It was a tough week. And where in these moments, where is the Good Shepherd, right? Where is he in these moments when you feel like you're being torn apart by wild beasts, when you're falling into the crevices, right? Where there's no green pastures in sight, there's no still waters. Your soul's too devastated to even consider restoration, and the thought of a full cup just feels cruel. Where is the Good Shepherd? We each have these moments, right? And if you haven't yet, you will. Because we live in a broken world, and we're living east of Eden, as it were, right? These moments without a shepherd, they're completely devastating, they're meaningless, and they're totally hopeless. But these moments, when you have a good shepherd, they're still completely devastating. They still crush you, but they're meaningful and they're filled with hope. You know, they're moments when your shepherd is looking to redeem and rescue you and lead you through these valleys to get to the table that he has prepared for you, to get to the place where he anoints your head with oil and your cup's running over. The good shepherd gives purpose to your pain. The good shepherd gives purpose, my sisters, to the things you're looking at the world and you're seeing and you're devastated. The good shepherd gives meaning to it. He gives purpose to it. 4 or 5 months after that horrible week, I remember sitting in a van with Becca, this mother who had lost her baby. And we were talking once again about, you know, the amount of grief and mourning on both of our parts over those last few months, the anguish cries to God, you know, the anger, the wrestling, the comfort, the hope, the anger again, all of it. And I remember she asked me, would you do this again? If you had to choose, would you go through this again? Whew, this woman, someday you'll have to have her come speak. She's a young, powerful woman of God. But the spiritual answer, the one that I'm trying to lead us to, is yes, absolutely. Because my shepherd is good, I can trust him, and he's teaching me, and he's guiding me, and he's leading me higher. But you know what I said? I said, Becca, I'm afraid to say yes. I'm afraid to say yes, I would choose it again, because in some messed up part of my mind, I'm afraid if I say yes, God will hear that and he'll make my cancer come back. Again, it's messed up, right? But that's where I was. That's what I was thinking. And I told her that through tears. But here's the thing. Those previous months of wrestling, they were not wasted. They were not wasted. They did shape me. They did change me. They shaped Becca. They led us toward this feast and the full cup that God has for us. But do you know the biggest way that they did so? They didn't do it by making me stronger, okay? They didn't do it by making me more capable or better able to go without a shepherd. You know, oh, now I'm strong enough to do it on my own. But they did convince me more than ever before how badly I needed a shepherd and how good my shepherd is. And what I learned about my shepherd during that time in a whole new way, I saw how trustworthy he is. I saw that I can't stand up under the weight of this world, but he can. He can stand up under the weight of everything that you see on the TV, of everything that you see in your family, of everything that you see when you walk out your front door. He can stand up under the weight of it. And here's the thing. He invites us in our times of need to come to his throne, which he calls a throne of grace. He calls his seat of power a throne of grace. During that time, guys, I failed in so many ways when I was faced with one of my worst crises. I wasn't enough. I drained my cup. I kicked my cup. Not only did I pour out my cup, I feel like I kicked my cup across the room a couple times, right? But he wasn't standing there with his arms crossed, being like, hey, you know, get it together. When you pull yourself together, Megan, then come talk to me and we'll talk. He knew that I wasn't enough. And not only did he live up to his end of the bargain, he helped me live up to my end of the bargain. He helped me to hold on. So this concept in the scriptures, the Hebrew word for that is chesed. Chesed is where this psalm ends, and it's where our meander will end. In Psalm 23, verse 6, it says, surely your goodness and your love, those two words together, goodness and love, that's chesed. Surely your chesed will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So this concept of chesed, guys, it's a game changer. It's a game changer. It's what makes our shepherd so deeply and profoundly good, because he plants himself by his flock and he promises to take on the care and well-being of each sheep in that flock, of every single woman on the call, he promises to plant himself by you and take care of you. His love and his mercy, the long-suffering grace, it does not depend on you or I being good sheep. As a matter of fact, he knows we're not going to be good sheep. It depends fully and completely on him and who he promised he would be. And look at that final promise. His chesed will follow me all the days of my life. He chases you with it. He comes after you with this loving kindness. He pursues you with it. One commentary I read said it was called hounded by chesed. He's after you. No wonder our cup can run over. So that brings us to our cup. And again, to the fact that he wants to fill yours up. Day by day, he wants you to keep looking at him. Keep your eyes fixed on him. Stop looking at the world. Look at him and trust that he will fill you up. And here's the thing, guys. Your shepherd, he is not stingy. Okay? It says he overfills our cup. He doesn't skimp. So what do we do with the excess? What do we do with the extra that's pouring out? Well, simple. We take our cup and we go pour it into the empty cups of the men and women surrounding us. And we can do it without fear. We can do it graciously because we're going to pour ourselves out. But guess what? We know where to come, and he's going to keep filling it up and keep filling it up. So, amen. That was not a good ending, but hopefully this gives you some food for thought and some things to wrestle with. But I'm grateful for you listening.
Oh my gosh.